Hello. In this video, we will take a look at a few fundamental properties of the spectrum and the resolvent set of a bounded linear operator T. The first result on this slide shows that the spectrum of T is always a closed subset of the complex plane, and correspondingly the resolvent set as its complement is open. In addition, the second result shows that the spectrum of a bounded linear operator is a bounded set which is contained in a closed disk on the complex plane, centered at the origin and having radius equal to the norm of T. The second result also states that both the spectrum and the resolvent of T are non-empty. And here we can note that the resolvent set not being empty follows immediately from the boundedness of the spectrum. In proving the previous results, we can use the so-called Neumann series, which is presented on this slide. And this result states that if the operator T has norm strictly less than 1, then the operator of the form I minus T has a bounded inverse which is given by an infinite series of powers of the operator T. This infinite series is considered in the space of bounded linear operators on X, and it converges with respect to the operator norm. And in addition, this result also gives us an estimate, an upper bound, for the norm of the inverse of I minus T in terms of the norm of the operator T. We can immediately observe that the Neumann series has precisely the same form as a geometric series of complex numbers, where the scalar powers have been replaced by the powers of the bounded operator T, obtained by composition of the operator T with itself. The proof of the Neumann series is quite straightforward. In the first part, we can use the property that the norm of T is less than 1 to show that the partial sums of the series form a Cauchy sequence in the space of bounded linear operators on X, and the series converges because this space is complete. In the second part, we can verify that if we compose the partial sum Sn with the operator I minus T from either side, we then get an operator which converges to the identity operator on X. And we can finally argue through the uniqueness of the limit of a convergent sequence that the Neumann series is really the inverse of I minus T. We can first apply the Neumann series in showing that the spectrum of a bounded linear operator is a bounded set. In the proof, we can take an arbitrary complex number lambda with modulus greater than the norm of T. We can now modify the operator lambda I minus T by taking lambda as a common scalar multiple of both of these terms. We then have an operator of the form I minus an bounded operator, and the norm of this bounded operator is strictly smaller than 1. Because of this, our result on the Neumann series implies that the operator lambda I minus T has bounded inverse, and therefore lambda is in the resolvent set of T by definition. Since lambda with modulus greater than the norm of T was arbitrary, we can conclude that all spectral points of T must indeed have modulus less than or equal to the norm of T. And finally, the property that the spectrum is not empty would require different kind of machinery, and we will not study this proof on our current course. As the second application of the Neumann series, we can now prove that the resolvent set is open. To do this, we take an arbitrary point in the resolvent set and aim to show that this point has a neighborhood which is completely contained in the resolvent set. To this end, we can take a complex number mu and consider the operator lambda plus mu times identity minus t. If we use the assumption that lambda I minus t is boundedly invertible, we can express the identity operator in the second term as the composition of lambda I minus t and its inverse. And this way, we can take the operator lambda I minus t as a common factor in the expression and arrive at the composition of lambda I minus t and another operator, which again has the form of I minus a bounded operator. In the second term, we have the scalar value mu as a scalar multiple, and thus also the norm of the second operator depends linearly on the size of mu. In particular, the norm of this operator is less than 1 whenever the modulus of mu is sufficiently small, namely less than 1 over the norm of the inverse of lambda I minus t. And if this condition holds, then our original operator is the composition of two boundedly invertible operators, and therefore boundedly invertible as well, and consequently lambda plus mu belongs to the resolvent set of T. This concludes that our point lambda indeed has a small neighborhood which is contained in the resolvent set, and since lambda was arbitrary, we have proved that the resolvent set of T is open. We can now consider another example, the left shift operator on the sequence space LP. This operator is defined so that the application of SL to the sequence X shifts all of the elements of X to the left by one position. This operator is a bounded linear operator on X, and its operator norm is equal to 1. Because of this, our earlier results show that the spectrum of SL must be contained in the closed unit disk of the complex plane. And in this example, we will show that the spectrum of SL is in fact this whole closed unit disk. We begin by considering the points inside the unit disk, meaning those values lambda which have absolute values strictly smaller than 1. Our aim is to show that all these values are in the point spectrum of SL. To do this, we can first expand the condition that lambda I minus SLX is equal to 0, as shown here. The condition that these two sequences are equal means that all their corresponding elements must be equal, and this way we can see that the eigenvalue equation holds precisely if the kth element of the sequence X is equal to the first element multiplied by lambda to the power k minus 1. Because of this, a non-zero vector X satisfies the eigenvalue equation precisely if it has the form of a non-zero scalar x1 times a sequence with increasing powers of lambda. This structure is both necessary and sufficient condition for the eigenvalue equation to hold, but we still need to determine whether or not the element x actually belongs to our space x of p-summable sequences. However, if we compute the infinite sum of absolute values of the elements of x to the power p, we then arrive at an expression which contains the geometric series of the scalar value modulus of lambda to the power p. And this series converges if and only if the scalar value is strictly less than 1, which is equivalent to lambda having modulus less than 1. This argument shows that every lambda with modulus strictly less than 1 is an eigenvalue of the left shift operator, and that this operator does not have any other eigenvalues. At this point, we know that the spectrum of SL must be contained in the closed unit disk, and on the other hand, that the whole interior of the disk belongs to the spectrum. Since we know, based on our earlier results, that the spectrum of operator is always closed, these two properties together imply that the spectrum of SL is in fact the whole closed unit disk. If we are interested, we can also study the more precise nature of the spectrum of SL, which lies on the unit circle of the complex plane. And if we do this, we will find that these points belong to the continuous spectrum of SL, and the residual spectrum of SL is empty. Finally, we can note that the spectrum of the right shift operator can be analyzed in a similar manner. Since also this operator has norm equal to 1, its spectrum is similarly contained in the closed unit disk. The structure of the spectrum turns out to be a bit different, since the right shift operator does not have any eigenvalues, but instead the open unit disk is contained in its residual spectrum. The boundary of the disk, on the other hand, is contained in the continuous spectrum of SR, similarly as in the case of the left shift operator. The operator lambda I minus t has a central role in the definition of the spectrum of t, and also its inverse is quite important. For a lambda in the resolvent set of t, the inverse of lambda I minus t is called the resolvent operator, and it's denoted by r lambda t. The resolvent operator appears often in the study of different kinds of properties of the operator t. Besides being defined as a single operator, it's sometimes useful or even essential to consider the resolvent as an operator-valued mapping on the resolvent set of t, mapping the complex value lambda to the resolvent operator r lambda t. This operator-valued function is a continuous function on the whole of resolvent set of t. In addition, if lambda and mu are two points in the resolvent set of t, then, as shown here, the resolvent operators at these two points commute. Moreover, the two resolvents r lambda t and r mu t also satisfy a nice operator identity, which is referred to as the resolvent identity, relating the difference between the two resolvents to their composition.